awesome. Well, let's grab a Bible. Let's grab a Bible. Please, grab a copy of God's Word. Let's jump into it. Let's learn. I want to pray with you as you grab a hold of a Bible, and we're gonna give ourselves over to God's Word tonight. You've made a decision to come, and so there's no authority here. There's authority in your hands. God's Word is the authority. It is the truth standard. It is correct in all things. And we've made a decision to come here, so let's take a moment and pray and let God know about the posture of your heart, okay? Father, we are overwhelmed with your beauty, with your power. We are blessed to be a people that have a word for love, Jesus. And we're thankful, Lord, that you have provided this perfect word that is the light to our path, the lamp to our feet, that is true, that it is pure, that it is perfect, that it is timeless. And so, Lord, all of us now here, we are putting ourselves under the authority of this word. So please speak to us. Let your Holy Spirit move. Lord, use your word and your spirit to accomplish your task here tonight in us all. This messenger is by no means able to convey a proper message on my own. I need you. And so we all do. I need you to lead me. And we need you to open up our heart, to examine it, and hold up God's word to it so we can know how to live. So I pray that you would give us that privilege now in Jesus' name. So Well, you can open your Bibles to Revelation chapter 3, but we've been going through this series called A Healthy Body because we want to examine ourselves and make sure that when the churches and the Bible jack up, that we don't do the same thing, right? So anyone ever heard of getting a checkup from the neck up? Did you ever hear that? Anyone ever say that to you? Get a checkup from the neck up. Just see what your thinking is, right? Check it out. Make sure that you're thinking right. But I would offer this, that there's more to getting a checkup from the neck up. I would say that combine that with an introspection of your midsection. It's your head and your heart together. That's where our decisions are made. That's the choice of our will. That's what we think. This is our worldviews all encapsulated into those two places in our mind and of our heart. The head is, of course, our knowledge, what we know, but our heart is what we feel and what we do. And so we need both. And so this series, A Healthy Body, would examine not only the church as a whole, but the individuals in the church to see if I'm on track. Am I on track? That's the question at hand. Or we as a group, have we drifted? And so we've been looking at churches to see if we've drifted. They drifted. They started out good and they got sideways in a lot of different ways. And so we've been examining these churches so that we could see, have we done this? If so, what does God's word say about getting back on track? Maybe we haven't done it yet, but maybe we want to prevent it from happening. You know, nobody wants to be a church right now that would say, you know what, someday I just hope that we can all get together and start getting drunk on the communion wine. Like, no one would say that that's their aspiration for their Bible-believing church. But we know this because in Scripture, that's what they did. They started taking communion, which is good, right? But they went sideways and they drifted. And so we've been examining these drifts. This week, I want to say this, that, and I don't know if you agree with me, but why don't you throw that first picture up there that I have in the computer. I would say that this week's drift is about our relationship with God. And some people have a relationship with God that, it looks a little bit like this. It's dry. It's barren. It's boring, right? It's lacking in life. There's no vitality there. Do you ever see a road like this? The tumbleweeds are just going by. There's just no life there. It's just dead. There's nothing there, right? And that's the life of too many Christians. But I would offer to you that that's not the life that God wants for you. I don't think that God looks at you and says, this is what I want in your relationship with me. I would think that he would want something a little bit different. Show the next thing. I think that he wants not just barren wasteland, but I think this is what God's looking for. I think this is what God wants. Something exciting, off the chain, right? Crazy exciting. He's the creator of heaven and earth, right? He came down from heaven to meet with you, to be in your life, to implant himself into your chest and be a part of your life. He wants it to be exciting, right? If this visual doesn't work for you, maybe this would be better. Maybe instead of our life being like one match, you ever light a match in a book of matches and you see one little flame? Well, maybe that's what our relationship with God is like. Maybe that's our Christian walk, a match. But you know, Paul tells Timothy, you can kill that. Paul tells Timothy to fan the flames of your faith. He wants it to be an inferno. He doesn't want it to be just a match. He wants your relationship with him to be exciting, an adventure, awesome, scary. Every emotion that he's put inside of your body, you should be using in your relationship with the Lord. And that means crying and laughing and fears and excitement. All of that should brew up inside of you in your relationship with the Lord. But that's not the case with most people. So when we look at, what I want to talk to you about is in Revelation, we're going to look at symptoms of the problem. We'll look at the sickness that is there, and then we're going to look at the solution. So it's a three-step process. Let's talk first about the symptoms that we're looking for that indicate this desert relationship, okay? The first thing I want to tell you, you're going to find it right there in the text in Revelation, is the symptom of the problem is an image problem. The image is this, that it appears that you're all right. It appears that your Christianity is rocking and everything's going well. The outer appearance looks like it's doing fine, but a careful examination of the inside, the truth is that it's not. It's not. Look in Revelation chapter 3, if you will, and let's just see what I'm talking about. Let's just see what the scriptures say to us. In Revelation chapter 3, I'm going to offer you two churches. One is the church in Sardis, and the other one is the church in Laodicea. And Jesus is talking to these churches. You see it in red. This is the Lord himself speaking. So take heed to what he says and see if you see yourself here. He talks to two churches about two things. They're very, very similar in nature, but the wording is a little bit different. But let's talk first about the church in Sardis. Let's see if we have an image problem. Look at what Jesus says in the end of verse 1. He says, quote, I know all the things you do, and that you have a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. You see that? See, you appear to others like it's rocking, like it's going well. My Christianity is healthy, but you're not. You see, Jesus saw the heart of the people. People saw them and saw that it was a church that was alive and their relationship with the Lord was good. Maybe there's a lot of religious activity going on, but there was nothing there. Underneath the surface was dead man's bones. He says, you have your reputation for being alive. You appear to be alive, but you are dead. And he says with an exclamation point, wake up! Strengthen what little remains, for even what is left is almost dead. I love this next statement, he says. I find that your actions do not meet the requirements of my God. Now, I don't know exactly what Jesus was thinking there. It doesn't say. But you can kind of, I don't want to use the word assume, but you can step away from the Bible and draw your own conclusions. What does he mean? He sees what they're doing. They appear to be a church that's functioning well. People are have their Bibles open. People have their hands up. People are putting money into the baskets. They're attending. They're saying their prayers before meals and bedtime and doing all these things. But Jesus knows better. They were going through the motions of church, but there was nothing on the inside. There was no substance in their relationship with the Lord. And so he says, I've noticed this, that what you're doing, it doesn't really meet what I really want for you. And so verse 3, he says, go back to what you heard and believed at first. You remember when you first got saved? Come on. Does anyone remember that? Put your hand up if you remember when you got saved. Awesome, right? Did you feel like you could just conquer the world by yourself? I'm going to tell every person, 7 billion, let me at them. I'm going to get the world saved, right? You were so fired up about Jesus. And then, I don't know, you tell me, something happens, right? And so he says, listen, get back there. Go back to what you heard and believed at first. Hold to it firmly. And then what churches don't talk about enough, but we need to, repent and turn to me again. Repent. Stop doing what you're doing. Stop doing this and do what I want. Now, you see there's an image problem there, right? You have the appearance. It looks like you're alive, but you're really not. Let's look over at the church at Laodicea. Verse 15. Looks familiar, doesn't it? He says, just like he said to Sardis, he says, I know all the things you do. How does that make you feel? You know, the Bible says that everything is naked and laid bare before the one to whom we must give an account. Nothing you do is hidden from God. Nothing. Now, that might make you encouraged, or it might scare you to death. I don't know, but I will say this. Jesus knows every single thing that you do. He goes on, he says, I know all the things that you do, that you are neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were one or the other. But since you are like lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. That's heavy, heavy talk from Jesus. But that's not where I want you to focus. This is where I want you to focus right here in verse 17. Look what he says. He says, you say I'm rich. I have everything I want. I don't need a thing. And don't you realize that you are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked? So once again, Jesus says, it looks, right? It looks like you're good. But the truth is that you're not. You say that you're rich. You say, I got it going on, man. My Christianity's rocking. My life is great. But Jesus doesn't look at the outside. He looks inside at your heart, and he sees that it's dead. There's nothing there. And so when you contrast these two statements from Jesus Christ to these church-going people, and you contrast these groups and these statements versus Jesus' statement in John 10:10, where he said, I came that you might have abundant life, you start thinking, there's something wrong here. There's something wrong here. There's a drift going on in the church. And maybe, possibly, you might say there's something wrong in me. I don't see a maturing faith in my life. I'm not experiencing less worry. I don't see a greater level of service or patience or kindness, or a growing love for people. I don't see a growing fruit of the Spirit inside of my body. I don't see me changing to be more like Jesus as I thought that I would. I don't see my level of generosity of my resources increasing that should be increasing as a mature believer in Christ. Your generosity would increase. That's what Christians do. How come that guy can quote verses, but I can't? Where are all the deep, meaningful relationships that the pastor keeps telling me about that are available for me in the church? I don't know what you'd call all these things, but I would tell you what God would call it. He would say that they worship me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. That's the drift of the church. We say that we're believers. We appear to be a believer, but certainly a careful introspection of our heart would tell us that we are not white hot passionate for God, that we are not on fire for God's purposes. We are not white hot for His word and for His kingdom and for the mission that He came and died to set us upon. There's a lethargy, there's a complacency in the church. And if you look back in Revelation chapter 3, verse 19, he calls it indifference. There's an indifference in the hearts of the people. Let me ask you this. Does your heart beat for the gospel of Christ? Does it beat for spreading the good news to the lost? Do you get excited? Let me ask you, listen. Do you get excited about reading God's word? Do you get excited about meditating on it day and night? Are you like Jeremiah, who said in chapter 15, verse 16, "When I discovered your words, I devoured them, and they are the joy and my heart's delight"? Is that you? Is that you? Are you fired up about what he did for you? Are you equally fired up about what he would do for others through you? By Wednesday or Thursday, are you getting eager and anticipating the gathering of Christ's bride with her groom, the Lord Jesus? Are you excited about this, or does someone have to beg you to come? Let me tell you something. What I'm telling you, this is going on in the heart of the Christian who's earnestly pursuing the Lord. It is. It is. So the question is that you? This is a tough message, but it's a needed one. Is this you? Is it you? Are you excited about God's word? Are you excited about gathering with his bride? Are you excited about what he did for you and what he could do through you for other people? Is this you? I hope that it is. It's my desire that this describes each and every one of you that sits in here tonight. I don't want to ever see just a room filled with people. I want to see a room filled with people that are so on fire that you can't sit next to them because you might catch. I'm talking about people that are on fire, Bible-devouring, Christ-sharing, serving, generous, Jesus freaks. That's what I'm talking about. People that are on fire for the Lord, not just filling seats. But unfortunately, that's not everyone, is it? Scotty, could you come help me, please? Come here. Scotty's going to help us. Who thinks Scotty should help us with a sermon tonight? Anybody? I think so, too. You know that was going to happen either way if they didn't cry. Why don't you have a seat, man? Why don't you do me a favor? Just start eating.
All right, I got you.
And don't stop until I tell you to, okay? You just go ahead and have some crackers. Well, that water's good, man. That's really good. Let me ask you guys a question. Who wants to see God do some God stuff? I'm talking about, like, you know, you open up the Bible and you see the Red Sea opening and people are walking on water and lepers are being healed and he's feeding like 5,000 people with that little tray of food. Like, that's what you want to see that stuff, right? I want to see that stuff too, big time. Don't you, do me a favor, look at Acts chapter 2. Go to Acts chapter 2. I never get tired of reading this. Go to Acts chapter 2. You want to be a church that sees God doing God stuff, right? I want to be a church that sees God doing God stuff, right? Am I alone? Anyone else? I want to see God do God stuff, right? I don't want to settle. I want to see him do incredible, incredible stuff, right? So look here. When you look in Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47, look what it says. It says, "All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to sharing in meals, including communion, Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all. The apostles were performing miraculous signs and wonders. And all the believers met together in one place. They shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day." Met, that wasn't enough though, right? No, that wasn't enough every day. "They also met in homes for the Lord's Supper and shared their meals with great joy and generosity." I don't see anyone pulling teeth to get them to do it. They were so into it. They had just seen the Christ that had gone to the cross and died. He came alive and they're like, what else would we do? Of course we're gonna do this. You don't have to pull teeth with me. Jesus is alive. So let's just do this thing, right? So it says that they were enjoying the goodwill of all the people, and each day, the Lord added to their fellowship. People were getting saved, man, like crazy. See, I want to see God do some God stuff. And when you look at the church in Acts chapter 2, look at the devotion, look at the prayer, look at the signs and wonders. Thousands of people, history would tell us, thousands of people were coming to the Lord constantly. They were gathering every day for prayer, all this kind of stuff, right? Don't you want to see that?
I want to see that.
I don't think that, those days are over, right? Because God is the same, yes, do it with me. He's the same yesterday, today, and what? Forever, right? He's the same God. So he can do this. I want revolution to be like this, don't you? I want to see it, right? So look, the Bible is not just simply a book of rules that tell us don't do this and do this. It's also a picture. We read stuff like this in Acts. It's a picture of what should be. It's not something you look back on fondly and go, hey man, they were rocking it back then. Wouldn't it be nice if maybe? No. No, no, no. This is in Scripture because it's there as a picture of what should be. It's highly descriptive. It's describing an amazing church. And this is what God does in a church when people are on fire for him. This is what he does. It's also a prescriptive, it's a prescriptive word that tells us not only is this what it used to look like, it also tells us what it should like be like right now. Come on now, that's the real amen spot. It should look like that right now. It should. Come on in, guys. Please make yourself comfortable. You're welcome here. Anyone happy that they're here?
Yeah.
Let them know. Awesome. You're very welcome to be here. So, not only does Scripture show us what a church should be like so it can experience God's best, so it can experience God's power, so it can experience God's presence, but it also tells us what we personally should be like so we can experience God's best and God's power and God's presence, right? To experience John 10:10. How you doing?
I'm doing all right.
Yeah, doing good? Getting a little thirsty? Yeah. So it shows us, listen, when Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it abundantly, I'm just going to kind of, I'm winging this one, right? It's not for you to make up your own Christianity. This is the way I'm going to do it, Jesus, but I want your promise. It's not I can make up my own Christianity and expect the promise that he gave that's attached to only one way. It's this way. So you can't get this promise on your Christianity. You get this promise on this Christianity. If you want God's stuff in your church, you have to be devoted to the word. You have to be devoted to prayer. You have to be devoted to the fellowship. You have to be devoted to generosity. You have to be devoted to goodwill. That's what you have to be. If you do that, that's his promise to you, that you will enjoy the abundant life. And you will see God do miraculous things in that church. Now look, I said that the Bible will show us a picture of what we should be like to experience God's best and his power and his presence. Can I give you some verses? It's just what we do, right? You can jot them down. I'm going to read them to you. You know, I need a drink. I'm kind of thirsty. Oh, that is delicious. So refreshing. Keep eating. You're not doing it fast enough. Eat. Jeremiah 29:13. If you seek me with your whole heart, you will find me. Hebrews 11:6. God is a rewarder of those who earnestly seek me. James 4:8. If you will come close to me, I will come close to you, the Lord says. Psalm 63, do me a favor, go to Psalm 63. I want you to see this, man. The Bible is not just a book of rules. It's a prescription of what you should be like to enjoy all that God wants for you. So I'm pleading with you to take heed to this word, okay? You ready? This is what he says. Psalm 63:1, oh God, you are my God. I earnestly search for you. My soul thirsts for you. My whole body longs for you in this parched. In this parched and weary land where there is no water. Look at verse 6. I lie awake thinking of you. meditating on you through the night. Loved ones, listen. Is that you? Psalm 84:2 is an anonymous psalmist. The one we just read is from King David. In Psalm 84:2, he says this, I long, yes, I faint with longing to enter the courts of the Lord. With my whole being, body, and soul, I will shout joyfully to the living God. Psalm 42, first two verses. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul longs for you. I thirst for God, the living God. See, all these verses tell of the Christian that craves and longs and desires and hungers and thirsts for God. Not God and His Word and His church as a supplement, but God as the main dish of your life. Why? I would tell you that I think, brothers and sisters, that you settle for lesser things. I think you satisfy your hunger and thirst with things that are only temporary and will never, ever, ever accomplish what you think they will. Look what David said in Psalm 63, what he said, this dry and parched and weary land where there's no water, it's not so much a judgment against everything else in the world, but it's a praise of God. Because in chapter 63, verse 2, he says, I have seen you in your sanctuary, God, and gazed upon your power and glory. Your unfailing love is better than life itself. How I praise you. I will praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer. If you wonder why people do it in church, you just got your answer right there. Here's the thing. You satisfy me more than the richest feast. I will praise you with songs of joy. So what he's saying here is that he's seen the things of the world that satisfy. Let's just use your food for a second because you're mowing on that. Sure, you're. Sure. Actually, I know her. Yeah, she's probably killing it, right? It's good, right? Anyone have this? Who had this? Anyone? Was it good? Praises? Awesome, right? Good stuff. Guess what happens in 2-3 hours? You need some more, don't you? In her, 20 minutes. This little one. Right? It doesn't satisfy. What he's saying here is, I've seen you, God. I've seen what you've done, and it's amazing. And I've seen this. It's good. But that is not as good as this. Amen. And so I was listening to a preacher recently. He talked about this, that we only have a certain capacity for hunger. And we are satisfying that capacity for hunger with things that will never satisfy them. They're lesser things. And what David's saying here is, I've had the things of this world, and compared to you and what you are and what you can provide and who you are, the rest of this is just parched, weary land where there's no water. I cannot be satisfied in anything else. In anything else. So, we're supposed to long and desire and hunger and thirst for God. And I think that's the drift. We don't. Scotty, how are you feeling over there?
Not too bad.
Yeah? I actually thought you'd be further along than that.
I mean, I don't need that stuff to begin
with. Yeah. Keep eating, man. Are you thirsty?
A little bit.
Yeah? Why don't you try two at a time? See what you got, man. Oh, there you go. That's it. Don't worry about the mess. Mark's going to clean it. I'm just kidding. How's that? Is it pretty good? Yeah. You really want some water, don't you? Yeah. Has water become a little bit more valuable to you now than it was maybe 20 minutes ago? A little bit more needed? Yeah. You got a thirst, don't you? So let me ask you this. Not just Scotty, but all of you. Does your soul thirst for God? See, he wants water right now. He's dry. He wants, his body is telling him something. I need some water. Do you ever hammer some crackers and you just feel like your mouth is just done, like you can't even, it turns into like a cast, you know? It's kind of what you're feeling a little bit, isn't it? Yeah. See, he's thirsting for something. All of a sudden, there's a greater desire for water than there was before. He has a thirst inside of him that he needs quenching. And my question to you is, do you thirst and hunger for God the way he thirsts and hungers for water right now? See, I think that's the real problem in the church above all things, that there's no great desire for the Lord. And when someone comes across your path that's on fire for Jesus, they stand out so much. Not because they're so on fire, it's because the rest of us are so not. That's why. And let me tell you something. When you read the Bible, Acts chapter 2, what he just shared, if someone that you knew was on fire for the Lord, if he walked into that church, would they even hardly notice? Because everyone was like that. That was standard operating procedure. Functioning as designed. That's the Christian. Not the exception, the rule. Let me share a little story with you. I'm embarrassed to tell you, but I will share it. Because if I don't confess my failures, you won't. It was a couple weeks ago when my dear wife was I took her to the hospital one night because she's had headaches for like 12 years every day. It's brutal. So you can only take so much ibuprofen. It just doesn't work anymore, you know? So she's popping them like they're M&Ms. It's not working. And then all of a sudden, the headaches of 12 years turned into spins. The whole room was spinning so bad, it was like, oh, honey, please. You know, it was that bad. Like, you know when you're, I know you guys never drank before, but when you were hammered, when your friends told you how drunk they were and the room was spinning, that's what she was going through. And she wasn't anywhere near the communion wine. So I said, that's it, no more, we're going to the hospital. Took her to the hospital. As far as she's concerned, they did blood work, brain scans. She's good. So they don't know what was going on with her. But I got her some vitamins. It seems to be better now. It's been like 2 weeks. 2 weeks she hasn't had a headache. That's insane. 12 years every day. And I got her these vitamins that are supposed to help with this stuff. And she's better. All that aside, so I left the hospital. We went overnight. I left the hospital because I had to go home to the house to watch the kids because Mimi was staying at the house with the kids. And I knew she had to go to work the next morning, so I was like, I got to go. So it was like 7 o'clock in the morning. I had to give her a little time to go home, take a shower and everything. So I go to the house, and she's like, no, I'm calling in sick. You just go. Go stay with your wife. Go. I'm going to take a sick day or a personal day or whatever they have at the sheriff's office. And so I said, all right, great. So I went back, but I was exhausted. Been up all night. So I stopped at the store to get a coffee or an energy drink or something. And as I'm walking out, here comes Kelly. Y'all know Kelly, right? He comes walking in. Because he's getting ready to go to work in Orlando. He goes this way. So I'm at my corner store. Some of you know where I live. Intervarius, where the Dunkin' Donuts is, where Taco John's used to be, right? So I'm sitting out there. Now listen, it's 7-something in the morning, right? And here's the front door to the gas station, all right? And I walk out and Kelly meets me right there. So we're in the spot right in front of the door. Now, every construction, hardy, tough guy is walking in and out of those doors at 7 o'clock in the morning getting their hot dogs for breakfast and their coffee, right? And their big drink. Am I lying? That's what's going on, right? So I'm sitting there, right? And we're sitting there. I'm telling him about Meredith, and he's like, can I pray for you? So he puts his arm around me, right? And we're sitting right there, and he puts his arm around me, and I put my arm around him. We're hugging right in front of the door, right? And he starts praying for my wife. That's awesome, right? So I'm sitting there, and I'm like, hey, this is great, except everyone thinks that we're gay, right? And so I'm embarrassed. I'm like, what is going on? And so that's my confession. Like, I'm thinking like this. Instead of thinking about the Lord and how awesome he is and praise the Lord and he's going to heal my wife and my friend is a good friend and he loves us, what am I doing? Man, what are people thinking? They're going to think that we're gay and they think we're weird. And I'm sitting there like this and I'm not praying. I'm like, oh, I'm freaking out. But all of a sudden, like, the Lord got a hold of this stupid kid. And my thoughts started to transition from, oh, they're going to think that we're weird, to, wait a minute, isn't this what we should be doing? Shouldn't this be the norm? What's wrong with you, Moses? What kind of pastor are you? You're embarrassed to pray. I mean, confession, right? It says confess to one another. Let me be the first. But he got a hold of me. I started realizing like that. This should be the way that we live. We're supposedly 70% Christians in this country, and we're weird, and it should be the norm. That shouldn't freak you out. That should be. Listen, I want to encourage you. Be the weirdos. The Bible says you're a peculiar people. Be peculiar. I already know you are, so just live it out. Just live it out. Does your soul thirst for God? How you doing? Have you had enough yet? Want some? Yeah. Who thinks that Scotty has done a great job?
Yeah.
And yeah. Thank you, brother. Thank you for helping to illustrate a point. That's okay. Just get it all over the place. And you can have some of my water, or you can get your own if you'd like. Whatever. So my question is, does your soul, do you have a hunger and a thirst for God? And when you answer that, is it just lip service? You know, do you worship him with your lips? Or is it a wholehearted pursuit of the living God? Is your spiritual life a bit dry? Does God seem a bit distant? Maybe it's because you're a bit indifferent, like the Bible says. It's not the Lord, it's us. The writer of Hebrews would put it a little bit more sternly. He'd say in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 29, that some people will treat the blood of the covenant which made us holy as if it were common and unholy. I'm a Christian by image, but my heart and my head and my actions don't display such a conversion. I'm spiritually dry and dull. And Jesus would tell the church in Sardis and the church in Laodicea to turn from your indifference and wake up. So the symptoms are an image problem. I appear to be okay. It looks like I'm doing well, but I'm really not. The sickness that causes the symptoms is that there's a lack of hunger and a lack of thirst and a lack of pursuit of the Lord. That's the problem. But there's a solution, okay? Here comes solution time. First off, let me tell you this. When it comes to a solution, I would say that there's hope. There's definitely hope. And we talked about hope last week. And hope is not just, I hope it's nice out, the weather's nice, 2 weeks from now when we go on our vacation. No, we're talking about a confident hope, an expectation hope, that the desire that of my heart will actually happen. The reason I can say that there's a solution and a hope is because, not because of anything I can come up with, but because of God's Word. God's Word says in Matthew 5, 6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. And listen, it's not about your righteousness, you getting better, because the Bible says your righteousness is like filthy rags. No improvement, no a better Hannah or a better Jared is not what God's looking for. He said, if you hunger and thirst for Christ's righteousness, the promise is you will be satisfied. There's hope. There's hope for a heart that is not thirsty. There's hope for a heart that is not hungry for the Lord. Psalm 146, we said it last week, verse 6 says that he keeps every promise forever. So when he says you will be blessed, I will satisfy your, if you come after me with a hunger and a thirst, I will satisfy that hunger. I will quench that thirst. You will never leave God's table hungry or thirsty ever. And so the process of solution is this. You have to notice and acknowledge the symptoms. You have to notice and acknowledge that I think I'm okay, but careful examination of my spiritual life, my relationship with the Lord is a little bit barren. It's a little bit dry. It's a little bit dead. It's not vibrant. It's not on fire. It's not an inferno. It's not a waterfall of blessing pouring all over you. It's a little bit dry and a little bit dull. So you have to acknowledge it and notice the symptoms. The second thing, you have to identify the problem. I have a lack of longing. I have a lack of hunger and thirst. I have no real desire for God and for His purposes and for His word. There's no "as the deer longs for streams" in my life. There's no "hot, I need Jesus" in my life. I'm pursuing Him. I can't wait to wake up in the morning and dig into the scriptures to see what God's word has for me today. I'm kind of going through the motions. So the solution is this. Two things. You have to ask God for help. And then you have to choose by faith to pursue God wholeheartedly. What do I mean? We'll go back to God's word. The first thing we have to do is ask God for help. So you can't save yourself, you know that? Your salvation is a gift from God. It's not anything that you've done to deserve it. Nobody can boast. And at the same time, no advancement in your relationship with God is something that you can conjure up on your own. Philippians 2:13 tells us that God gives you the desire and the power, or some translations would say, the desire and the will to do what pleases Him. It's not something you can conjure up on your own, and if you do, it's going to be weak and it's not going to last. And so you have to come to God and say, "Listen, Lord, I acknowledge the fact that my relationship with You is a little bit dry. It feels like You're a little bit distant from me. And I want to do better. I want a better relationship with You. I want the fireworks going on in my life. I want to see my life, my family, my church. I want to see God stuff going on in my church. I want a supernatural church. I want to be a supernatural person. But I'm not." And so you have to ask God for help. You have to just say, "Lord, I need You to help me with that. I need You to give me the will and the desire to do what pleases You." In Your word, it shows what pleases You. It's this amazing church in the book of Acts where they were devoted to this stuff. And people were getting saved like crazy. And there were miraculous signs and wonders going on. It was incredible because they were devoted. They had a hunger and a thirst for God that was amazing. And nothing could quench that thirst except the Lord Jesus. And that's what we need. Lord, we need You to give us the desire and the power to do what pleases You. And then in faith, you have to choose to hunger. That's a big word. We have to choose by faith to hunger and thirst. We have to choose by faith to long for Him, to earnestly seek Him, to search Him with our whole heart. Why can we do this in faith? Well, Jesus tells us in Mark 11:24 that when you pray, if you believe that you received it, it will be yours. And so you need to, when you come to the Lord and you say, "Lord, I need You to give me the will and the power to desire You, to search for You with my whole heart. I want to come after You. I don't want to be begged for the things of God. I want to beg You for the things of God." And you have to believe when you pray that to Him, "Lord Jesus, help me with this." You have to believe that you have received it and it will be yours. That's God's promise, not mine. So we ask the Lord to give you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. And then in that power, choose well to go after Jesus big time, believing that He gave you the power to do so. And He always keeps His promises. Amen? So listen, if you hunger and thirst for Him, He will satisfy those cravings in abundance. That's the promise of God. And Revolution, I would just say this. Diligently turn from your indifference. Diligently turn from your indifference. And diligently pursue the Lord. How do we do this? Fasting, praying, committing to attending, committing to reading, choosing to serve, choosing to give. That's how we do it. That's how we do it. We pray. We say, God, I have a problem. I'm dry. I see others that seem to be on fire for the Lord, and I envy them. That's the relationship I want with you, Lord Jesus, but I don't seem to have it. And I've tried to have some New Year's resolutions to read the Bible in a year, and I've gone through my reading plan, and it just doesn't seem to grab any traction. And I want to be one of those people that are on fire for you. I want to go to the ends of the earth, and I want to give 12 years of my life, and maybe no one will even get saved, but my success is obedience. And maybe that's you. Maybe you need to recognize the symptoms in your life. Maybe the problem is that you just don't have a hunger or a thirst for the things of God. So I want to do this as we close. I want to spend some time with you. I want to encourage you to do some things. You came here tonight. You came here tonight. You made the choice to come here. And I don't want this to be a waste of your time. God does not want this to be a waste of your time. I don't want this to be a waste of your time. I said earlier that we settle for lesser things, lesser satisfactions, lesser temporary fixes to the hungers and the thirsts in our life. When we're thirsty, we just go grab a bottle of water, don't we? Go grab a cup of coffee. We're hungry, just go grab a bowl of cereal. Go make a PB&J. Just instant gratification. Here's the thing. God wants you to spend time in His Word. God wants you to spend time on your knees praying. God wants you to spend time in fellowship with other believers, sharing your spiritual gift to build each other up. He wants you to do those things. But when those things come across your radar, all of a sudden, you might just pop on a ball game and sit and watch. And all of a sudden, Bible's put back down again. You're trying, you wanna go to church that night, but all of a sudden a buddy calls and you're satisfied with that and off you go. And God backseat again. You're satisfying your hungers and thirsts with things that are just temporary because the ball game ends, right? The friendship sometimes ends. Certainly the night will end with your friend. But God's eternal. And His Word lives forever. And He's calling you to those things. And so what I want to challenge you to do, and I've never done this before. I want to challenge you to start purging out the things that satisfy your hungers temporarily by fasting. I want to introduce fasting to this church. And I'm not saying we have to, all of us right now, sign in blood that come every Saturday, you're not eating. No, that's not what I'm asking. I'm asking you to join me in prayer here in just a moment to ask God, God, what do I need to get rid of that's temporarily and unsatisfactorily killing my cravings? And therefore, I have no craving for you. Do you know what I'm saying? So maybe when you pray, maybe He says, I want you to just give up lunches. Maybe He's saying, I want you to fast on Sunday. Maybe He's saying, I want you to put your phone down for a week. Maybe He's saying, no social media for a month. Maybe He's saying, go on a 30-day fast, no food. I don't know what He's going to tell you. But I want you to open up your heart and your awareness to Him and let Him speak to you. We need to purge out the evil that's in our heart. Get rid of the things that only satisfy for a moment. With fasting. You know, the Bible tells us that there's certain evils that can only be removed through prayer and fasting. Did you know that? And there's a cancer in the church. It's called indifference. And Jesus talks about it to the church in Laodicea. And I fear that it's in churches across our world. There's no hunger and there's no thirst for God. There's no, as the deer pants for streams of water, I need to have a drink. There's none of that for the things of God, for the mission of God, for God's Word, for the people of God. There's none of that. So why don't you join me in a few moments of prayer. Let's talk to the Lord. He shared His Word with you here tonight. And so now I would ask you to bow your heads, and instead of hearing the word that goes out to all of us, right, let's now enter into his presence individually and start hearing the individual word he has for each and every one of you now, based on what you've heard tonight. Father God, I'm going to start with me, and I'm going to acknowledge my sin of indifference, my sin of complacency. Lord, I have been radically transformed and saved, taken out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of light. I've been moved from death to eternal life by the Father of lights. From the one in whom all good things come down from. Who are we, Lord, that you are mindful of us? But yet you love us so much that you sent your Son so we could have a wonderful, loving, vibrant, adventurous relationship with you forever. Lord, I ask right now that you would help me to understand where I'm indifferent. Help me. And then, Lord, I pray, not just for me, but for all of us now in this room, Lord. And all of us that are here, if you want to join me in this prayer, you can. Lord, we're asking that you would give us the will and the power to do what pleases you. Lord, we settle for things that don't satisfy. We settle for things that don't last. They're temporary, and you're eternal. You even said in your word that you came so we would have life and have it abundantly, and yet most of us, truth be known, we're not living the abundant life that you want. We're a bit dry, a little bit barren, a little bit quiet, a little bit dull. You seem a little distant, Lord. But I'm reminded of James, where it said that if we come close to you, then you would come close to us. So maybe you're far away because we're not earnestly pursuing you. Give us the will and the desire to earnestly pursue you. We want to be a supernatural church. Therefore, we want to be supernatural people. Lord, give us the ability to walk by faith, to walk this thing out, whatever it is that you speak to us now. As we go quiet for a moment, you speak to us individually. Give us the power, that same power that raised Christ from the dead, that lives in us. Give us this power to walk out what you tell us now. God has spoken to you on an individual basis at any point here tonight. Raise your hand. Evidence, look around and move the hands up. Look at the hands up. Evidence of the living God. Evidence of the living God. Earlier, we sang a song called King of my heart. Now you sang that song because it was up here on the screen and the band was playing it. Almost like your captive audience, right? Now you heard the song. And now you've heard the message. The message that says, don't bring me praise with your lips, but have your heart far from me. Now he just spoke to you. You have an opportunity now to sing it again, but now you have an opportunity to sing it without, don't bring an empty offering to his altar. Don't bring words. When it says, Lord, I want you to be the wind in my sail. I want you to be the anchor in my waves. I want you to be the fountain that I drink deeply from. Don't bring an empty offering to the altar. Sing it with your whole heart. Pursuing Christ with your whole heart can start right now. Amen? Right now, you've prayed. You've asked Him to give you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. Now, in faith, stand up and sing to the King.